of you just joining us, and I'm just going to confirm that we're on, but I am Lauren from RDU on Stage, and I'm here with the lovely and talented Amy Kirk-Jones, who is doing some amazing design work for the upcoming Women's Theater Festival production of Freak Show, which I'm really excited to see, because I think it's a full production. It's not a reading. And I love that they're embracing this new virtual proscenium, as they're calling it. Love that. So I want to talk about you. And I kind of chuckled when I read some of your bio, because it says you started playing with power tools in high school. And full disclosure, I took one set design class in college because I minored in theater. Mm-hmm. And they asked me to sign a waiver after the first week that I would never touch the power tools after my first week there. So talk to me about your first show, that first theater experience.
I got into theater, and I grew up in a small town. I mean, my hometown is Talking Rock, Georgia, which is one of those that even you can go an hour away to Atlanta and go, do you know where Talking Rock is? And people don't. So it's like one of those, you know, one stop light town sort of places. But small town, high school, and drama seemed like one of those things that was kind of cool to get into, just because I was in the band. I was already, you know, that kid. So it seemed like that was the next step. And to get into doing anything on stage, you automatically signed on to do things backstage. And I wanted to be on stage at the time. I decided that was not for me pretty soon. But that was some of my favorite time with the show, was actually getting to be backstage and, you know, pulling out these amazing tools that my dad used all the time, because he did carpentry and things like that. So it was all of a sudden like, oh, I can use these things too. And oh, wow, when I'm done, this thing is created, and it's sometimes a useful thing. Sometimes it's just a pretty thing. But I think that was kind of my first exposure to the art of theater is not just, you know, these people up here saying lines and creating that sort of the poetry and the pomp and the circumstance of all that goes into theater. I realized that part of the artwork was these little things behind the stage. And if you didn't have those, you weren't going to have that stuff on there. So I kind of fell in love with it. Not on purpose, because it was a means to an end as it started out. And then it got more fun as things went on. So by the time I was in college, that's all I wanted to do. I realized I had a assistant director, in fact, that or a director. I was his assistant director, who told me when I took that job and I had to take it as part of my major, he basically came to me and said, you're never going to want to go back up on stage after you do this. And I was like, we'll talk about that afterwards. I've not acted since, not in any, you know, on purpose sort of thing. So I picked up my first drill and realized, there's a little bit of power behind this. And I'm sure that was part of it too. Braces, take those out. You are mute on my end, so I'm not sure what you just asked me.
I told you I was going to put it on mute because they're doing the lawn, so I didn't want to. But what I find beautiful about this is when I look at set design, good design to me just enhances that storytelling. So what makes good design for you? What is good design?
For me, good design is, it doesn't take away from what the actors are presenting. I guess it sounds kind of pedestrian to say it this way, but it, as long as my design makes sense, I mean, I hope it's beautiful. I hope it's something that brings joy to anybody that's looking at it, but I want it to to obviously follow the story and fit seamlessly together so that your mind isn't distracted when you look at it, that you are transported to that space. I want someone to feel totally immersed in the experience when they're in that design. I want them that if I am, you know, if you're sitting in an audience looking at a proscenium, I want you to forget that those walls are there. I want you to be a part of what's going on. I want set pieces that when you look at them, there's a backstory to it. We have one piece in this show that is our cook wagon. Our cook wagon is based off the design of a Calliope wagon from Ringling Brothers and Barnum & Bailey Circus. And the idea we had was this is a show, the freak show, the traveling circus. This has gotten older. It's running down. It's coming to the end of its life. And they don't have the money that they once had for this show. They don't have all of the guilt and all of the fabulous that it would have been in its heyday. So we decided that Calliope wagon was perfect because they've had the Calliope wagon. At some point in time, they took the Calliope out. It was still a sturdy wagon. It still served its purpose to move from point A to point B. So they turned it into the cook wagon. And I love to do pieces like that you can look at it and say, oh, there's a backstory to that makes perfect sense. I feel like there's something about that can transport someone to that time and that space, and they understand, okay, there's more going on. There's these little nuances. That's what good design is to me, when you've got these little things that you can look at and go, ah, there's a story there. And I hope that the audience can pick up at least just an inkling of that story to make them maybe, you know, walk away from it going, okay, there's layers to it. And it's not just, okay, this is this blank background that we're putting actors in front of. I want there to be a little bit more to it that makes mind, even if you're not consciously going, oh, wait, there's such and such there, that at least your mind is kind of in the background going, huh, there's more to it than I was thinking. Those little details, even on a grand, regular, well, I say grand, anything is life size is grand now because I've been working in little bitty tiny, but I hope that they walk away with a little bit of that in their background.
Sorry, real life, this is my husband.
Exactly.
So I let me ask you this. Give me one second. Let me ask you this. With Freak Show, there was, it was originally supposed to be staged at Pure Life. It was a full-fledged production. It wasn't really intended initially for this virtual space. So walk me through what your initial vision for the show was going to be when you were going to be on a traditional stage.
When I got this show, I was actually in Georgia dealing with some family stuff and had been there for an extended amount of time. So I had some time to sit down and go, okay, let me explore this idea. And of course, you give a designer something with Freak Show in the title, and it's just like, oh my gosh, this is an amazing thing. In fact, when I got the job, I don't think I even asked what theater we were in at first. It was just when I found out, that was even better. But I had envisioned literally walking into the lobby, having the ticket booth and having the lobby look like you were going into the circus tent and have those elements, having the ticket booth there, having the posters on the wall, very much that circus tent effect, and the idea that you were literally walking into a circus tent and you had your, you know, the various spaces for the different acts that be in a circus, just like, you know, a boardwalk circus tent would have been, which Pure Life actually lends itself very nicely to the way it's set up. It was going to be very much that you were walking into, as an audience member, into the Freak Show, like you, it just very immersive. And suddenly the tent got taken away thanks to quarantine. So that that's been my big challenge with all of this, is to try to bring, and the whole cast and crew has been, to bring back that sense of immersion when you're looking at a screen. And it's the difference, and you've got a black box theater where you can make that immersion so real. You know, there's a difference if I had been given a proscenium and saying, okay, you have to, we've went even further to, not only do you not have a proscenium now, you've got a flat thing that you're going to have to try to bring that immersion to. And I think we've done an amazing job with the things that we put in place. But going from this grand vision of, you know, canvas on the walls so that you had that enclosed feeling, and, you know, all the ties and ropes and things that would have been there to make you feel like you're inside that tent. And yeah, the vision changed dramatically overnight, literally. But yeah, I was very excited about that space, because it is such an immersive space to begin with. And you had very, very, very good bones to work with there. And suddenly my bones got taken away.
So when you have this big black box theater, mm-hmm. or any theater that you're working mm-hmm. with, you know, what I'm always impressed with set design is that I think love is in the details. So when I look at a set and I see more details, and then I kind of wonder how much is my brain actually making up in the details. So when you're working in this big space, a regular theater space, can you fake it more than when you're scaling down to a miniature?
Yes, actually, that's been one of the things that we keep talking about with this one. In theater, I'm sure you're familiar, we have something, or designers at least, we have the 20-foot rule. The great thing about the 20-foot rule is nobody is going to be close, especially in a proscenium, nobody's going to be closer than 20 feet. In a black box, you've got less of that, but you've still got a good 5-foot rule there at least. This particular one, I went at it from, there's a camera that's going to be this close from the details of what I've done. And part of the production, there's filming of the set that has taken place that ties in. And, you know, I'm sitting there watching the camera person, Jade, they're down here like, okay, we're and looking into windows and all this stuff. And I'm like, okay, really glad I went with the detail there. But yeah, when you're dealing with life-size sets, you have a lot of leeway as far as, okay, I'm really good at making wood look like other wood. That's kind of what I do, because I'm used to being up there where I can, okay, yeah, I can fake this. When you're dealing in detail like this, it went out the window. Everything has had to be pretty dead on. And I've been working in the scale of 1 to 24, which means 1 foot equals half an inch in everything that I've done. So yeah, detail, it's been a bit of a change, because, you know, even in props and stuff, you sit there and make a prop, and with, like, I'll talk to other prop people, and it's always like, we want to put more detail into props a lot of the time, and you have to kind of pull yourself back and say, no, there's no point in doing it so detailed, they're never going to see that, why put the time there? Whereas now, I'm going back, even looking at it now, going, you know, I could have detailed that a little bit more. I could have put just a little bit more there to make it a little bit, you know, more to scale. But I mean, like, I've got books in this thing that are like half inch, because one of the characters has books laying beside their aquarium. So little things like that. And I've been wiring little spaces that are, you know, that big. So, and I'm not used to doing lighting on these things. Lighting is not my thing. But
well, your lighting, you're usually, I mean, and what I love is when I was kind of reading through your bio, you usually wear multiple hats. It's usually like design, props master, and goodness knows what else that's probably not listed in the program, because most of these community theater, regional theater productions are scrappy.
I play in a lot of dark spaces, yeah.
but what I really, what drew me in and why I wanted to chat with you, and there are so many amazing people involved in this production, but what drew me in was that initial photograph that you shared on social media, and I guess mm-hmm. Women's Theater Festival shared on mm-hmm. social media, of the circus cart, the circus mm-hmm. train, I guess, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And Johanna, I just texted her because she's watching with us right uh-huh. now. I said, Amy has the sets next to her. Can we show them? And she said, yes. So
excellent.
We've got permission. So these sets are, I'm obsessed with. So
let's see how it comes out.
Oh my, look how amazing and detailed it is. It's lit. So I know you were doing some 3D printing with this.
Yeah.
So talk to me about the process.
Because I've got to, even though I do miniatures, let me see if I can turn the light back off on this without, there we go. I do miniatures like for fun. As a scenic designer, I do a lot. I always do a model whenever I do a design. One, I do better work in 3D than I do in 2D drawings because I'm not that great at drawing. But two, the director needs that model to be able to move, you know, there, even if it's just mentally looking at it, to move actors around and figure out where things are going to be and stuff. They always get that model. When I started doing theater, it kind of became one of these things where I was doing more and more miniatures, even though I've loved them since childhood, doing more and more of them as a hobby. And I've picked up a lot of techniques doing that and stuff. But again, those models usually aren't that detailed. When I got to do this one, it was like, oh, I have some fun toys that I haven't really used in my miniatures, so I can do fun things. And one of the cool things that it's led to, we've done several, or I chose to do several designs that were different kinds of miniatures in this process. I do have a 3D printer. So in the case of the this cart, and then on the Pinhead cage, I was able to print 3D parts. On that one, it's maybe 50% 3D printed. The cook wagon is completely 3D printed. And I actually went online and again found a Calliope wagon that somebody that was a train enthusiast had put together the pieces to. And I was like, you know, I can take that basic and turn it into what I want. So we were able to do that. Most of the pieces on what I just showed you are 3D printed. This is obviously cloth, but this part's 3D printed. And then I put in some interior pieces. The tables are 3D printed, all the little stools and the fire and everything. And this one were, which was nice to have because it made it easy to pull up pieces and parts and put things together and make it work for what I needed. I can't imagine how much time it would have taken just to try to get the stools glued together otherwise, because it's just such small things. In the case of, and I'm going to try to show this.
So can we talk about the 3D printing process for a second?
Yeah.
How long does it take you? I mean, from what I had, I only watched part of a piece being 3D printed, and it was such a lengthy process. It takes hours and hours. So the foot cart, how long are we talking?
Each wall on the cart took around 2 to 3 hours. The most intricate pieces, and that's the front and back because they have all the detail work and the archway over it. Those took about 3 hours. All the other pieces took about 2. And I didn't print them as detailed as I could have simply because I knew I was going to be painting them when I was done. So that there's a little bit of leeway when you know you're going to be painting over things. The wheels I printed all together at once. I think they took about an hour and a half. So all told, I have to do math. This is a scary thing. There's probably about 18 to 20 hours of printing in the cart. And then like the tables and stuff, I did multiple things at the same time. So those pieces maybe took another 3 hours, 4 hours total to get all that done. So it takes a little while to do.
Yeah. And are you coding as well as, I mean, because I'm thinking that with 3D printing or your coding as well.
Yeah, there's a wonderful thing out there called Thingiverse that has a library of all sorts of things. The nice thing about the 3D community is it's a very inclusive, I mean, it's got problems like any community, but they're very maker oriented. So there's a lot of people out there sharing their talents and sharing things that they've made and encouraging people to take things that they've made and make other things from it. It's that kind of community of creativity. And the wonderful thing about it is a lot of this stuff was out there in various forms. And I mean, there's a pretty big miniature community within the 3D community. A lot of it's gaming miniatures, shockingly enough, but you can find other things there. So there was enough base designs out there that I could take and then pull into, you know, different programs and slice it up the way I wanted it to, and then feed it into my program that will then code it to go to my printer and make it come out the way I want it to look. Hopefully, sometimes it doesn't do exactly what I want, but for the most part, I've gotten it down to enough of a science that I can make it do what I want most of the time. So I did figure out that there is a limit on how small my printer will go. I started trying to print utensils for the kitchen cart, and it did not like that. That was just beyond its scope. It was like, nope, I'm not printing anymore. But yeah, it takes a bit of time to do that one. And I mean, there's probably, I would say probably 10 to 12 hours on just this part that I put in as far as figuring out what I had and you know, what I could make things into. And that's after a few years of playing with it. I can't imagine that it would be that, there would be a lot more time going into it if I was just starting out playing with that part, so.
Absolutely. Okay, now show me the second piece. People are loving this kind of behind the scenes look. This is so exciting to me.
The other piece that got 3D printing was this one right here, and this is what we keep referring to as the pinhead. And our pinhead has kind of a circus cage in there, and the tops and bottoms and the door were 3D printed, and then those are bamboo skewers that fit in there nicely. I think it was originally designed to be a birdcage, and she's got a little hay pallet back in there. I don't know if you can see that very well, and if I turn it just right. She's also got a little table and some of her things, or the character is his things that he has accumulated. There's some tin cups in there. There's a blanket and a stool. And I also got to play a bit with some resin casting as well, because the top pieces are all resin on these, because I wanted to make those a little bit more ornate, and you can't get real ornate in small detail on the 3D printer at all. It doesn't like that. But one of the other ones that I really enjoy doing, this particular one is actually paper, and it's all paper. The fun thing about this one, obviously we're back in the 1930s era with the freak show, but this particular miniature, and I didn't know this as much about miniatures when I started into it, but this particular miniature is a style that actually goes back to the 1800s and before. I mean, there's some much earlier, but this particular one is based on, and it's kind of an amalgamation of several designs that I found, but they date back to the 1800s. This particular one is French, and that was actually a style that they were doing miniatures in at the time. It was a very popular thing to be able to cut out and glue together and have a beautiful miniature piece. And in the original, some of them actually twirled around as a carousel. I did not go that far with this one, but it was kind of neat looking at the history of that when we were, you know, going back to another time. And I hadn't really thought about that being, but it was a popular, cheap way to get, much like paper dolls or anything like that at the time. This particular one is also done in resin. And I had fun with it because we were trying to make it more of a marble effect. So I got to carve the column and then went back and made a mold of it and cast it. That was the other interesting thing about this one. We have pieces and parts trying to make the immersion. We have pieces and parts in different people's homes. We have one major set, and then we have pieces in other places. to bring that home. So several of the pieces I made three different versions of. I did not the cook wagon because I didn't have time with, you know, just the time it was taking to do it. But there are three different versions, or not versions, they all look alike, but there's three different sets of that pedestal for the character named Amalia. There are three different aquariums for the aqua boy, our human salamander. And there's three different pinhead cages out there. So that was a bit of a fear for me, making three things that were going to look exactly alike and be in three different places. And part of that was we were wanting that immersion effect, and that's trying to reinforce that. So trying to make those identical was a bit of a fear going into it, because I wasn't sure that the details were going to hold. I think we've done a pretty good job of that, but there was a bit of a scary moments going through that one.
And talk to me about the color story. When you're designing for a screen, I'm imagining that the colors, that color story is going to look a lot different than when you're designing for a stage, a traditional proscenium stage.
It is.
Talk to me about that.
And I came in with, you know, the directors were very definite in kind of where they wanted to go with colors. That was one of the things, that pieces of information I had going in. And we were going with the kind of the rust red, for lack of a better way of describing it. We were trying to do that kind of that dried blood feel, which it has different connotations, but that rust red is a very popular color in freak shows and such, mostly I'm sure for that reason, because it's kind of a lurid color that gets your mind going places. The other colors we were going for were kind of the way they were originally described were kind of the body fluid family of greens and yellows and blues. So they've got kind of that yellowish tinge to them and that sort of thing. And that was what I had, which is a great color scheme to go with. And that was what was going into the design early on. Well, then all of a sudden, now that we're on camera, the thing that we've realized in the, I went through, I think I said eight or nine different meetings with actors, because our challenge is taking this set that we can look at and say, oh, here's this cohesive thing in one place. And then dividing it up into all these little screens in actors' homes, because that's where they're stuck right now, and trying to carry that sense of immersion on. So we've been meeting with those actors to say, okay, what have you got in your house? And trying to replicate the color scheme and trying to replicate the look. Well, not everybody's cameras on their computers are the same. Not everybody's screens are the same. The screens that people are going to be looking at it on are not all going to register the colors the same. So it's been this weird adventure in trying to come up with words to describe colors to the other people in the meeting, going, well, okay, I'm seeing this when I see their screen. That's been the challenge. I mean, I know how these colors read because I will hold them up camera and go, okay, that's what it's going to look like on mine. So yeah, we're still in the right place, but I'm used to being in design meetings and holding up a swatch of cloth or a color or something like that, going, okay, this is the color we've got. Well, that went to holding it up in a Zoom meeting and saying, okay, this is the color. In real life, it dries a different color and it's going to look a little. So there's been an adjustment, and then we took it that step further when we're looking at, okay, so-and-so has this curtain in their house and it looks like this, and we can make it be part of this, and the color is going to come through as that dried rust red. Okay, we've got that one. And then we would go to another one, and, you know, it becomes a comparing of pictures and comparing of notes of, okay, this was the tonal quality I got over here. And yeah, color theory is out the window. I consciously know computers are this way. I work with them enough to know that part, but I don't think I had really adjusted in my brain what that meant for our new circumstances here, because it's been an adventure in learning what colors look like. And then somebody will tell me something of like, oh no, this is not even really a red color. It's brown. I'm like, well, okay, it's reading red. Let's go with it.
Well, and what's interesting to me is I think designers speak their own language. And I say that with all utmost respect. Okay. And then actors have a language of their own. Directors, I think, have their own language.
Oh, yeah.
When you're in the same room, you know, you can have this show and tell. You have these visuals, you have swatches, you have sketches. Do you think creating in this virtual space has made you better able to communicate about design with non-designers?
I hope so. I think it's given me a lot of new tools to be able to do that. You know, we've been moving towards more and more digital collaboration over the years anyway. I mean, I watched that happening, but we still always had that fallback of, you know what, we've got a production meeting on Monday, I'll show you then. You know, there was always that trying to show and tell and describe what something was, and when it just didn't work, you knew you had this fallback of, I'm going to be seeing you in person, so I can show you what I mean. We don't have that anymore. So yeah, I think it's given me new tools, and I don't know if our languages are combining, or we're all just making up a new kind of, you know, this is what this, like the fact that I keep describing the red as, okay, it's a dry blood, you know, there's new terms that we're trying to come up with, that rather than saying, okay, this is a lovely, you know, it's falling somewhere between scarlet and perhaps a vermilion. There's things that I would think too in terms of color things, and you know that, yeah, an actor's going to look at me and go, unless they've worked, you know, somewhere in design, they're going to say, I don't know what that is. You're going to have to be a little more specific. But I think it has us moving towards a more generalized way of expressing, and I think it's probably teaching us all a little bit more patience too. And I have to give kudos to this group, because oh my gosh, the patience that has been displayed, and just the willingness of actors actors that are having to sit there in a meeting and help with design. That's not what they do. They come onto a stage and they do their thing, and you might give them a tutorial on what to do with a set piece or a prop, you know, but these are actors that I'm teaching them, you know, or they're teaching me in some cases, okay, we have these pieces. If you've got some blue painter's tape in the house, but we're figuring out ways of hanging things, and they're having to do that for me. I've not got a deck crew that's going to go in there and do that. So it's very different way of expressing those things, and just being patient with the, okay, if we hang this here, and I'm going to tell you to do something kind of funny that, you know, but it's not going to be seen on camera, so it's going to look the way we want it to look, but it's going to sound really stupid. But yeah, just, oh my gosh, these actors and other crew too, coming in and saying, hey, how about if we did this way? We've got one piece on here, Amalia's Pedestal. It's weird because I typically, there's a lot of flexibility that you're going to go into regardless. That's how that happens. But going into it with flexibility, originally there were going to be almost kind of stalls along the back of the tent to show the individual spaces, and especially Amalia's, because there's some set some scenic direction within the script that calls for her to have a space that can be contained within a curtain. Going through the back and forth of trying to set up that nesting space for the character, and trying to figure out how to make a curtain read and putting a background on a blank wall. And these are people that have gone around their houses, and their technical challenges involve, do we have outlets for lights? Do we have a place to put, you know, computer cameras, and do we have a blank enough wall that we can make it look like the space that we, you know, that those are some of the things that you never really think about in scenic design, because you're building the wall. It's not an issue. But in doing that space, there was this weird back and forth of, okay, we found the fabric that we can use that's off with Rowan in a different state, so it's getting shipped. So Rowan put together a beautiful piece of curtaining for us, shipped it down, and it's being shipped to Carrie Ann, our actress playing Amalia. And then we were running into the problem of Carrie Ann is nesting in her grandparents' house, and we can't do anything really to the wall. So, you know, all this back and forth. Well, all of a sudden, a trifold screen comes into play, and we realize, or I realized in when I went to put in some curtaining, I'm like, oh my gosh, after fixing this in the real life space, that works better in my small space too. So all of a sudden that trifold got me, but there's always a flexibility, but I don't think I've ever had that part of design come back to influence my original design, because it's always been the original design going all the way through, and you modify to make things work when they don't work out right. But I don't think I've ever had, you know, the, okay, we're fixing this, and have it come back like that. So it's, yeah, there's new things at every corner, and it's not what I expected the new things to be. I mean, I knew we were going into a whole new world, but and that's something that a lot of the others have said too, that you didn't, going into it, we knew we were up against some challenges, that it, you know, this is a whole new media kind of, but at the same time, the things that have come out of it is just this sense of collaboration coming from places you didn't expect. Theater's always collaboration, but it's not, this has been a whole new level of it, and it's been a new level of helping each other out and being there for the other members of the team. That was not the part that I think most of us expected to come out of it. We expected we would have to work hard as a team, but there's been so many neat collaborative moments that have come from there that have been just, I don't have the words for it, but it has been just like this incredible experience to be in that. And I think that's probably why a lot of us do theater. I mean, you do it for the art, and you do it for, you do it for the applause too. I mean, that's definitely part of it, but the sense of community that has come from this one has just been awe-inspiring. And I can't say that enough. I don't have the words for that part of it, but.
I'm kind of wondering because the actors have been put in the position of being co-designers, mm-hmm. and kind of having to build their space, mm-hmm. within their space, mm-hmm. Within their nest. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if that has helped them discover and define their characters a little bit.
I think in some cases it has. I hope it has. I know, I'm sure it's like, there's a lot of little details from it that are coming, I think, into play, because it's a different use of space than I'm sure there, because I mean, you're used to having a whole stage, whereas, you know, you have to stay in this little square or rectangle or box, you know. So I'm sure they're using that a lot differently, and I'm sure it's made changes in how they're doing it. Even Salamander, I know there have been some things that have come, very much acting choices that have come from their space. They're actually using a bathtub as to mimic the aquarium stage. And I don't think I showed that one, but to kind of give an idea if they haven't seen. Mm. The round space here is our aquarium. And it's, again, we were finding old things from the time that we actually found a kind of similar style aquarium from the 1920s, I think it was. It was just absolutely stunning. But she's mimicking that in her bathtub. So I'm sure a lot of actions and stuff, as far as how they're able to work within that space, are coming from the space that they're now confined to. I don't know how much it has on some of the others. I am just starting to actually get to see everything coming together. I've not sat in a lot of rehearsals until now, more design type meeting stuff, but there's things that they're coming up with in those design meetings saying, well, hey, I've got the character doing this. How about we do this to, you know, Mr. Flip when that we were putting together their space, was saying, okay, I've got this tambourine that I picked up along the line, and I kind of feel like that might be in the, you know, and that's the ringmaster and the owner of the show. So, you know, they're bringing that in going, hey, how would this look on the wall? And it was perfect. I mean, even like the color scheme was perfect on it. Beaten up in places and, you know, the tin top, the whole nine yards. So it was just perfect. There's musical instruments that they were bringing in that hung on the wall saying, you know, I think this might be something that would be more my character's speed. They were coming up with curtains and such. So yeah, I think there probably has been more of a melding of making their space their own. And then I've brought back little things that I could to incorporate into the pieces. In hindsight, I really would have loved to get to actually design space for Flip. It wasn't one of the spaces we needed in the set, but when doing it for the space, they had to obviously have it for their background. So that was kind of an interesting thing, but just the design elements that they brought into their space, it's just like, oh, I would have loved to actually have designed, you know, their little, probably a caravan in their case. But yeah, there's little things like that that we've brought in, kind of designed a few spaces that wouldn't have been seen in the theater that are now being seen. So we've designed a backstory to go with those, and the actors helped out with that. So yeah, there, I think there's more of a, they're more married to the ideas that they're bringing into their spaces than they normally would be, because normally it's me giving them a space and saying, here's what you've got, you know, this is what I've gleaned from character motivation and stuff. And every once in a while, I'll pick up something that goes, hey, we can tweak this a little bit. So when they make acting choices, but yeah, I think there's more probably design choices being made through the actors' decisions than decisions being made based on what I've given them design-wise than normal, which is a little bit different dynamic.
Right. So you're in Tech Week as we speak, because the show opens Friday.
Yes.
What I'm wondering, what does a virtual Tech Week look like?
You're still learning that. We went into first dress last night, and it's already been different because, you know, load-in is normally everybody shows up at the theater space and brings in the things that have been being worked on, and whether it's being worked on in somebody's home shop. I have a pretty, you know, elaborate garage as far as being able to do sets and stuff, because I am a power tool aficionado. My kids buy me new power tools every year for Mother's Day. That's their thing. So I can pretty much build set pieces in my garage workshop, but you know, different theaters do have shops on site or off site, but designated shop space, it just varies. But load-in is normally everybody gets all that stuff together. The props person grabs everything from whether it's the prop closet or their house, you know, it all comes together in one space. Load-in has been spreadsheets and, you know, delivery schedules and, okay, this thing is coming in shipped by such and such. I have these things on this side of town. Somebody else has the other side of town. And since it's all these different addresses, we've been, you know, dividing up, okay, so-and-so is going to this side of town today. So if you're closer to them, hand it to them and drop off. I had two characters that one of them was picking up some fabric from their house. So I'm dropping off things at one actor's house, and then the other actor was, you know. So it's been a whole different ball game from that side of tech. There's been on the lighting side, which is no longer just lighting. It's also lighting and filming and IT, and, you know, Anthony Buckner is just a wizard, and I love the man. But there have been shuttles back and forth with getting, you know, lights to this person. And I'm headed out to Greensboro this afternoon to get some lights and a few last minute things to Amalia, because Amalia's out in Greensboro. And so, yeah, there's been that difference. And then now, you know, last night was everybody shows up for dress rehearsal, and there's that scurry of getting makeup on and doing, and they're doing most of the stuff, you know, either not on camera, but, you know, in listening range and things like that. And fixing nests and making sure the nests look the way we want them to, making sure the lighting's. So yeah, there, you know, it's the lighting adjustment like it would be in a normal theater, but you're doing it via a Zoom call and try. Oh, that's been the weirdest. Sorry, just had one of those moments, but you always have the whole right, left, stage, we know this language, you know, being in theater, but now we're on camera and camera mirrors and stuff. Right, left, stage, you know, it's like sitting here going, okay, wait, your left, which, yeah, over there, no, other side. There's a lot of that going on because the left and right thing is no, and I feel like, you know, that kindergartner that doesn't know their left anymore, because you're getting to that point of, okay, raise your left hand, so I'm, yeah, that's.
That's it. Well, it's terrible. Until you're doing these Zoom calls, I don't think you realize that, because just Barbara and I, she walked me through a dance, and she was like, okay, move your left leg. And so I would, and she's like, no, your other leg. And I was like, seriously, I know my left from right, but on Zoom, right. I don't.
Exactly. And that's, it's kind of like that. Wait, you know, I live in stage right, stage left, because that's the world, you know? And then I'm looking at it going, wait, no, wait, okay, just, yeah, raise your, yep, that way. So we'll just go with that. So there's been, you know, there's a lot of that going on, and then everybody gets in the room, and oh gosh, I'm sure Anthony and Allie and the stage management crew could just give you days of information about what they had to go through as far as dry tech and cues. And from what I have seen of it, it's an amazingly complex thing, and I have no clue how I would manage in that. But yeah, it's been different, and it's very different going through the, even going through notes and stuff. Zoom's kind of neat in that you can separate out into rooms and things like that, which I wasn't aware it had the technology to even do that starting this. So there's a little bit of that whole pulling someone aside to, you know, talk to them and stuff. But I made a comment getting out of one of the meetings that I had never realized just how much tech and design happened in hallways after meetings. And it just, it's one of those things that you naturally do it with the, hey, grabbing somebody after a meeting to say, here, let me show you something real quick, and let's talk this out. And it's a 5-minute conversation, and you don't think about it because you know you're seeing that person and can just run it by, you know, little things like that. Now that we're on Zoom, it's either a text message, which doesn't always convey what you're, because you can't talk with your hands in a text message. And obviously I do that, but, yeah, I mean, it's, you don't have that here, let me grab someone for 5 minutes. And if you're in a call with 20 other people, you don't want to keep all those people for this 5 minutes of, hey, me and, you know, lighting need to talk a little bit about how we're going to do this. So that's been a weird sort of thing, because, you know, yeah, you can hop on and do a quick Zoom call with someone, and that's great. But I was so used to, yeah, I'm seeing so-and-so at the production meeting, I'll just grab them in the hallway afterwards. And there's so many decisions that get made from that, that I never thought about, hey, this is where that stuff comes up. And when you're in a call, you're trying not to talk all over each other and stuff, and you can't just lean over to the guy that's sitting beside you or the person on the other side. You know, that's not there anymore, to be able to do those little small bits of stuff. And I just had no clue how much we had been doing of that, because that's where a lot of that stuff comes in.
I find this crazy hard to believe, but you know, I feel like we need to bring this up and talk about this. According to a study by the League of Professional Theater Women, and I think they studied it over 7 seasons off Broadway, women only account for 8 to 21% of lighting designers, 16 to 21% of sound designers, 21 to 35% of set designers. The only design area where women reign supreme is in costuming. So talk to me about how difficult it is to be a woman in tech, how the challenges you've had being a female set designer, props master.
I have been very, very blessed. And I say that just because I am lucky that in the Triangle, we do have a bit more parity than I think you see in the rest of the world with it. That doesn't mean that every year when the Tonys come out, I'm not sitting there grumbling every time I see the nominations. But I have been blessed in that here in the Triangle, there are several other female designers that are very, very active, and we're lucky in that respect. However, you run across things, and it's not, I used to think that I didn't see the discrimination simply because I'm almost 6 feet tall. I'm not a little person. I don't get a lot of blowback about being female a lot of the time, just because I grew up kind of being one of the guys anyway. So I'm lucky in that respect. And I've never felt uncomfortable walking into, you know, a shop full of guys. And a lot of times you do, you may walk in and be one of only one or two women in there. So there's that difference. I have actually seen more of an issue in, lucky because of where I'm at, but I've seen more of an issue in the things that are offered to us to be able to do our jobs. And I think it's a weird thing, but I think that's kind of where some of this starts. I have a weird little thing that I have a particular impact driver that I recommend to every female person, small person in general, smaller handed person, I guess would be the better way to put it. As far as that's my recommendation when they start doing carpentry and things like that on a theater set, simply because the brand I use has a smaller grip. Most impact drivers, especially up until the last few years when batteries are getting lighter and stuff, the grip was almost too big for a smaller woman's hand to be able to, you know, work for a long period of time. Impact drivers are great. Most women have a little bit less upper body strength than men do typically, or males do, going into the design of the tool, which is a weird little thing, but it's something that will affect you over time. An impact driver actually typically works better for us women than the men, simply because of it adds in a little bit on that upper body strength, which is, again, a little detail, but that's something that's being offered out there, is these are the tools of the trade. It's a weird thing, but if we're not able to have access to tools that work for us, and I'm not saying, you know, all those nice pink glittery toolboxes that you see for women to help, you know, around the house. I want good quality tools. I want my things that are going to last for me. And there are, again, a couple of brands are doing smaller grips now just because batteries are getting lighter and things like that, which is great. But you notice these things, and I don't notice them as much, but I have started noticing it in the last few years, just because, like, I did a workshop with Women's Theater Festival the first year on set design, and we had four or five people in there, and we looked up, we were doing it at Meredith College, and ended up getting an opportunity to do some welding and, you know, do some things that wouldn't have normally been a possibility, so it was great. But we go into looking at the equipment, and, you know, here we are at a women's college with a female professor that is out there trying, and tech director trying to get the equipment that her typical students would need. And she wasn't able to get small enough masks. She wasn't able to get small enough welding gloves because it's just not there. So I'm starting to realize more and more that, yes, it's the people we work with. That's an important thing. And we are lucky here. We're lucky that we've got the support we get. I don't see in the shops around the Triangle that I have worked in, I have not seen a lot of issues with whether you're male or female, or I'm not getting a lot of that, or, you know, but I do find that what I'm offered to be able to work with becomes an issue, which is not something I thought about early on. And that, I think that's a deeper societal issue, because they're not, the people that make these things aren't thinking, hey, women are going to be using them. It's still that mental, which I know that's a little bit more philosophical than you were thinking, but that's kind of what it started boiling down to for me, because when I look at tools and stuff, it's very present for me these days to be able to say, okay, wait a minute. If somebody's borrowing my tool, chances are, I hope that person is going to be a woman that's working with me, or I've got a daughter. I'm all for getting her more, and she's a theater set person. So I'm looking for things that, and she's not 6 feet, much to her chagrin, but you know, I want something that she can pick up and use too. And I, it's just not out there as much as it should be, which is kind of silly, but.
So somebody asked on Facebook if there's a recording of this interview. And yes, if you are joining us late, the whole thing is being recorded and you'll be able to watch it in its entirety afterward. And you'll want to, because there was some really great show and tell earlier. So you don't want to miss that. One of the studies I read from American for the Arts, and this one was just published last year, is that one of the main obstacles that kept women from going into tech or design fields was not only gender discrimination, but the lack of support for working parents.
Yes.
You're a working parent.
I am.
And now we're all quarantined with our husbands and children, and we're living in this interesting kind of work, home, family bubble.
Yep.
Talk to me about those challenges of juggling your work life and family life, especially now.
I got out of college, and straight out of college, I became a park ranger with the, and don't ask, I know that's like a big divergence from English theater, but yeah, it had been summer camp jobs. But when I got out of school, I took a bit of a break with the plan that I was going to, you know, at the very least do theater as a hobby. Well, then I got married and, you know, things hadn't been, park ranger is not the job to do theater as a hobby. You do a lot of weekends and nights there anyway. So once I got married, my thought was, okay, now I can get back into theater and do my passion. Well, then I had kids within, you know, a year and a half or so. And I had done a little, I dabbled just a tiny bit doing some props and stuff, just starting to get into it before I had kids. And all of a sudden I had kids and I did not do theater again for almost 12 years. So at that point I didn't find that balance. By the time I did, my kids were, you know, able to do their own thing. Then again, I wasn't out there actively trying to find the things, because it was one of those where I'm sure there were probably maybe some things around that were helping. Now, I mean, we've got groups in the Triangle, and maybe we are ahead of the curve, because I learn things every day about how lucky the Triangle theater community is to have the community we have. We have groups here in the theater, Sea Dark Share, Women's Theater Festival supports it as well. There's multiple groups now that are making an effort to make sure that women who have children who want to be doing the theater and doing the thing that they love or the work that they love, have that opportunity and have the support to be able to do it. Again, up until my kids were getting back to a point where they could be kind of on their own, I never found the balance. It's a difficult thing. I got very lucky. My daughter actually got me back into theater after I had kind of thought that that was a pipe dream and I would do it once the kids were up and, you know, doing their own thing. I got very lucky in that she pulled me back in. She needed something for a school play her chorus class was doing their end of year, they did a musical, kind of a medley thing, but they needed a stage for it, or a something on the stage, so they just weren't all standing up there. And my daughter, I had been doing props freelance for renovators, which was a very easy thing to do in my free time, but I didn't have to be there on site. I could ship things. Didn't have to be in person thing, so it worked. But she knew I had been doing that, and she stood up and told her chorus teacher. She says, "Yeah, my mom can build a backdrop for you. That's what she did. She's got a degree in that stuff." I have no clue where she got that from. I mean, she'd obviously overheard it somewhere, but here's my little fourth grader basically selling all of my services. And I'm like, okay, I haven't built a set of right. Sure, I can do this. And next thing I know, I'm knee deep in paint and muslin on my driveway and going, okay, yeah, I've missed this. So I kind of lucked up there, but before that, yeah, I had no clue how to do the balance. It was easy when I was doing it for her in school. And as my kids got more into theater, it got easier because I tend to take a lot of jobs where I know I can bring my kid with me. And I am lucky that they're awesome helpers. My daughter has been my assistant on this whole set. I mean, she would hate me saying it this way, but she's the best gopher ever. She's great for, hey, can you get me such and such? She knows what all the tapes and adhesives and tools are. So she works with that. And in this particular one, and hopefully this isn't a spoiler, there is fire involved in some of the set, and we were having to do the filming for that. And she was all about joining in to help out with that part, because of course there was fire involved.
There was fire.
Exactly. So, yeah, the last few years I've been lucky because there is more support, and I still tend to take jobs that I know, even if my child isn't able to, and she's 16 now too, but isn't able to get in and truly help work on something, I take places that I know are going to be welcoming to her presence. And the same thing with my son. He actually does lighting design. So, and he's moved off on me to Georgia now and is looking at opportunities down there. But when he was up here, I tried, and I actually got lucky and got to work 3 or 4 shows where I got to design with him. So that was a nice way to work with my child. And, but I like this movement towards being more inclusive with mothers, with kids, and giving them opportunities to, whether it's childcare or, you know, a safe space for kids to be in and work with their parents. So.
And Johanna shared on the Facebook page, and I will share the link as well when mm-hmm. I post the video later. We have a very active PAL chapter mm-hmm. here as well yes. that supports parents in theater. And so I think that is very cool. We'll share that link.
I'm curious, and I haven't done the research on it, but I'm always a little bit curious seeing how we're getting much more progressive again here in the theater, in the Triangle Theater. But again, I know we're lucky here. I'm always a little curious how other areas are doing with that, because that is such an important thing. I mean, that's in any, you know, mom work life balance, that's an important thing. But theater is one of those that, you know, we don't work normal hours in theater. And yeah, it's a big stumbling block.
It is. And I think for me, I mean, I can only speak for myself, but for me, I feel like I'm actually a better parent when I'm able to spend some of my time doing the things that I love.
Oh, yeah.
That may not have anything to do with my children. So I think I'm a big advocate for that.
Even before my kids were able to get more involved in the theater, that was one of the things that I realized that, I was getting to that point of I had been parenting and I was a stay-at-home mom, and that was what I had been doing for 15 years at the point where I started doing theater again. And I almost immediately felt like, okay, this is making me, I've got a therapist that backs up, because she's like, are you doing any shows right now? Because, you know, but there's still a balance, because my daughter does go through times of, okay, mom, you have done 5 shows back to back. I need you to take a break because I need a mom time here. And so we work on that balance now, but it's gone the other direction from me not doing any theater to making sure that I don't do too much. And I have to take breaks to make sure that I'm spending some home time too.
So let's get back to Freak Show, because I'm really, like I said, I'm super excited about this show. What do you hope will be some of the lessons learned, and maybe, you know, as a crew, as a creative team, mm-hmm. you're going to look back and you'll realize what lessons have been learned, but what do you think the lessons are learned for the creative team? And what do you think some of the lessons will be learned for the audience watching it?
I think starting for the audience, I think it's just going to be a whole new experience. I hope they walk away realizing that theater isn't just something that can happen in a certain building. And I know we do a lot of that, but it's still always live with people in, if not in touching, but in reach of you, because you're there, you're in the moment. And that's what, for me, what makes theater what it is that ephemeral nature of it. It is not something that is, there's no permanence to it. It is a moment, and it's like any other amazing moment. You're in it and you experience it, and then you have a memory of it. It's not something you can take with you physically. You can just get the memories of it. And if it were any other way, it would lose some of the quality of what makes it magical. I think we have this natural tendency to think of anything that's on that screen has more permanence, because typically it's a film, or we're filming it, or we're making some documentation of it. And to me, that takes away a little bit of that feeling. I think what we're bringing, or hoping to bring, is to still have that magic, to still be in that moment, to still be experiencing it as it happens, and having that knowledge that when it's over, the experience is over, and you take what you've experienced with you, and take those memories that still got that ephemeral nature. That's what I hope. Because there's a dichotomy between when you're building something like a set, because it is a physical thing that's there, and to have it be a part of something that's just a momentary thing is kind of a little bit of magic, because, you know, things that are built of wood and heavy and sometimes unmovable, those things seem like they should be staying there. But in the magic theater, it's not. It's still part of this illusion. From a technical perspective, I think we've learned a lot more about communication. I think we're, again, patience is something that I've learned a lot of. I think flexibility, and technicians typically are pretty flexible people. Designers are pretty flexible people. We kind of have to be. But I think that there's even more appreciation for that now. I'm learning a lot of appreciation for what technical capabilities are out there that I never thought about. And I think for me, at least, I've got so many things going through my mind as far as what constitutes a set. It's kind of almost philosophical in the way you think about it. But, you know, as a scenic designer, I have an idea of what constitutes being a set. And sometimes it's a building I walk into. I mean, I've done, you know, in immersion things with, like, I did Miracle Worker in the Borden House, where that was our set, you know. So sometimes it's a set that's there that you get and you work with it. But I'm learning all kinds of things about what constitutes what a set is. Is a set a physical thing that you build? Is it a background you put together for a live performance? Because I never thought about that. I think about green screens and stuff for film, but that's film. I do theater. I don't do film. So it's really expanded for me personally, my definition of what a set is, because it's become this very, again, back to the ephemerals. It is an ephemeral thing. It's things that actors have literally conjured up from their living rooms, or, you know, this thing that I have stuck in the storage. That's where this has all come from. So it there's a magical quality to that, but it does have me redefining, and it has me thinking about what theater going forward is going to be, because we don't seem to be a lot closer to figuring out all the ins and outs of this virus we've got going around. So I don't know when we're going to be back in a position where we can all be gathered in a theater together. Not that small shows aren't wonderful. They are. There's a magic there too, but there's something wonderful about sitting in an audience with 100 other people, or 200 or 300, watching this thing at the same time. There's an energy to that I'm not sure when we'll get to experience again. So it's a brave new frontier, and I have no clue how far we can go with it, but I want to learn, and I want to be a part of it, and I want to see all the things that we can do now. And I'm curious as how much of this is going to carry over, because, I mean, one of the things in set design that's already an element we really like to use is projection stuff. So, you know, that's one of those things that I'm sure 30, 40 years ago, nobody ever would have thought about. And now it's a very important part of what we do. Now we've got virtual involved. So sky's the limit. And I'm really excited to see where we can go with it. I think all of us are. I mean, you know, we've got somebody who came in as the lighting designer who has now designed how to bring a room full of people together virtually so that they can see. And we've talked about, you know, intermission rooms and things like that. And I'm not even sure how all of that is coming together, but, you know, the idea that people could be in a virtual lobby over intermission discussing what they've just seen, just like you would in a real. Oh, it's amazing. Technology is so cool.
It's exciting. It's very exciting. I miss live. I I think we all miss live.
Oh, yes.
But, you know, we can't do that right now safely. So
exactly.
I think this is very exciting way to embrace everyone's creativity. I mean, I think what's happening right now is so amazingly creative.
Oh, yeah. I'm excited to see how things may meld together when we can get back to at least some semblance of normal. When we can get those spaces back, I'm curious to see how much of this is going to hold over that we can still use and continue forward with. Because I think it's going to rewrite a bit of what we think about from theater.
Well, I love that we've had this conversation. I told prior to us going on camera, I started as a visual artist. Mm-hmm. So before the journalism part of this, I started as a visual artist. This is one of my very favorite pieces
I made.
So I got to take out the trapeze artist. This was a collaborative piece I did with Catherine Thornton, who's an amazing visual artist. She sculpted, we had a photograph. I'm obsessed with ephemera. We had a photograph of this trapeze artist, probably a very similar photograph to what you did the carousel with, the Calliope mm-hmm. with. It was this old vintage photograph of these trapeze artists. And I said, mm-hmm. I want to make that trapeze artist in mm-hmm. dimension. And so it's created out of polymer clay. And on the beads are vintage posters from Ringling Brothers.
Cool.
So that was like my whole work aesthetic. And so I was like, wait, I have to find the necklace and put it on. So I'm glad you got me, gave me a chance to take the trapeze artist out for a bit.
You're sitting there talking about posters. Yeah, we have them.
I love it.
Okay.
I love it. And I love these old vintage posters. Look at that ticket booth. The detail here, I'm gonna put you on speaker view so people can see how amazing this is. And while you're showing the ticket booth, I'm going to tell people there is an Eventbrite page you can go to. You can register and buy your ticket to see Freak Show virtually this weekend. I think we all need to be there. Oh, look at the posters. I love this. This looks so amazing. I'm very excited about this. This is one of the few virtual theater events I've gotten super excited about because of the creativity and because it is a full production, not just a reading, not just mm-hmm. a virtual talk back. So I'm really excited about this.
Well, thank you.
And we will be there reviewing it. So it's a new normal for everybody.
Excellent.
Thank you so much, Amy, for joining me.
Thank you for having me. This has been a delight. Thank you.
Thank you for Johanna for putting the links on her Facebook comments and for, being so innovative. I think Women's Theater Festival has embraced this new technology in a way that is really exciting. So congratulations to them because they just jumped on it right away. And we'll see you guys this weekend. Friday night is the premiere, the 29th at midnight. Mm-hmm. I think it's the premiere. The 30th is opening day. There's going to be some special virtual events surrounding the opening. And then there are several performances this weekend. So people can go on to the Women's Theater Festival social media pages or the website and find out more information, and we'll share those links.
Yeah, it's this weekend and next. So
thank you so much. Everybody, come back tonight at 7 p.m. I will be with one of my Theater Critics Association colleagues, Edward Medina. Edward is a theater critic, a writer, producer, director. He worked with Jim Henson. That's where he got his start. So I can't wait to talk about that. And he was an engineer on the train at Disney World. So I can't wait to talk about that. So he's got a lot of perspective on this. So come back at 7 p.m. right here on Facebook Live and join us. And everybody, as soon as we log off, buy your tickets for Freak Show.
Yes, please.
Anyway, thank you. And thank you, Women's Theater Festival. And I will see you soon. I'll see you this weekend.
Bye-bye.
Bye.